Hello, this is Chris Bennett. Join us weekly at Pot TV on the Burning Shiva Hour as we explore the roots of cannabis culture throughout history and around the globe. On pottv.net, home of the herb.
Hi, this is Chris Bennett with the Burning Shiva Hour. Like to say, we have Jonathan Ott here with us today, probably the foremost writer on entheogenic substances in the modern era. And very, very, very glad to have him. And you're up here promoting a conference, is that right, Jonathan?
Yes, correct. It's called Entheobotany 2, and it's 11th through 13 May at the Whistler Convention Center, Whistler Mountain, BC. And it's the fifth in a biennial series of conferences that go back to 1992, I guess it was. And it's a very international group. I should mention the focus is on the science, the underlying science. It's not about shamanism or its practice. It's about the science of shamanic plants, so the subtitle is Shamanic Plant Science. It's very international. There are about 20 of us that dedicate ourselves to this field of research. We alternate between Europe and the Americas, so it's every 2 years, and we try to be in a different country each time. So the first one was in Mexico in 92, then we went to Spain in 94, then we were in San Francisco over USA in 96, Amsterdam 98, we slipped a year in the schedule, and now we're in BC. So I think it'll be the first time ever for something of this focus and this size in Canada. It's not about hemp per se, but we are going to be covering the subject, in that we have Lester Grinspoon from Harvard Medical School on the faculty, who will be talking about medical marijuana.
I really enjoyed the lecture you gave the other night. We'll be showing a bit of footage from that on TV as well.
Oh, yeah, that is being recorded.
And you're writing anything currently, Jonathan? Or?
Yeah, I have in press. I finished it about a year and a half ago, but I have a book on shamanic snuffs called that, Shamanic Snuffs or Entheogenic Rinds, which I'm actually printing in Mexico for a change, and marketing out of Europe. I'm not too keen on what's going on in the United States, where I haven't lived for 13 years, and don't plan to go back in any time in the near future. But it's gotten really dangerous there. There have been some moves now against publishing in the United States. When the state started passing these medical marijuana initiatives, civil war never really ended in the U.S., and now it's playing out over the medical marijuana issue.
She was a good girl until she visited DopeFiends.com bookshop. Hey kid, want to buy a book? Here, I got something to show you.
Welcome to DopeFiends.com. We provide you with information that is safe, profitable, and productive. Learn safety techniques that will help keep your plants, shrooms, and laboratories clean, well-maintained, and hidden from any nosy neighbors. Be more profitable by knowing the best varieties for you, best techniques, and the best maintenance for your operation. Want to increase your productivity? We have books and videos that will show you how to utilize your space more efficiently, written by professionals in the field. So now that you have the information, and you know where to get it, and you know where to find it, be wise and buy from DopeFiends.com for all your growing knowledge and esoteric wisdom.
Hello, my name is Brian Taylor, and I'm the leader of the BC Marijuana Party. Marijuana prohibition in this province is costing billions of dollars and doing tremendous damage to our communities. I urge you to vote with your conscience and vote BC Marijuana Party.
Yeah, well, what happened in Arizona was the state, it was a state initiative, a people's initiative, where they went over the heads of the legislature and the governor and so forth and passed this medical marijuana bill. And then the federal government opposed this. And one of the ways they did that is they went to a well-known publisher, I won't name, that had published some books on marijuana cultivation, and demanded under an administrative subpoena from the Drug Enforcement Administration that he turn over the names of any customers in the state of Arizona so that they could investigate them, get search warrants or whatever. Well, to their credit, this publisher refused to do it, and indeed such a thing wasn't really legally binding. But since then, they've actually been debacting a law in Congress. Now,
activism here 11 years ago, 12 years ago, it was illegal to sell High Times to promote it.
Really?
Any literature that promoted legalization, you were liable for $100,000, $150,000 fine. And that got, I think, put out about 94. A number of booksellers and stuff like Mark Emery continued to sell High Times and challenge the law, and finally it was pushed out. But it was really did change things for here for a long time. It just made the whole drug war that much more effective because there was no voice to the opposite. You know?
Right. Yeah, it seems like things have really changed in B.C. because when I lived in Washington State up until about 86, 87, we always heard that B.C. was kind of traditionally the more conservative laws of Canada as far as the provinces go, and now I can see that's quite different.
Yeah, a bit of activism.
I'm happy to see.
That's for sure. Yeah, it's been good here, and but there's a lot of retaliation against that. United Nations a few weeks back had a declaration directly against BC Bud and
really?
The lax attitude about marijuana here.
Yeah, well, we have to remember the United Nations is not on our side.
Yeah,
against prohibition. They've been leading the charge for a long time, long before there was a CIA in it. Well, a little before there was a CIA, and long before there was a DEA, we had the United Nations trying to stamp out coke in South America, for instance.
Yeah. In your talk the other night, I found it kind of interesting that you yourself kind of said, just the way that you interpreted the experiences from it. Somebody like yourself, who has like read so much, obviously, and has come into contact with so many people that has ingested these entheogens, I find it hard to believe that you wouldn't draw some sort of like maybe commonalities from the experiences that you hear and make some generalizations. You're like basically said that, you know, you just saw everything as energy. Oh, it's like I see that one like too, right? Of course,
mm-hmm.
right? Everything is energy.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty big in itself, I think.
Yes.
But as far as not having any visions or so much, it didn't really sound like you had a religious experience from what I got out of you.
Well, I was just trying to be more precise linguistically. Maybe I didn't get the point across because I want to make sure people are understanding me on the same terms. I wouldn't describe it as religious. Spiritual, yes, but to me that's a different thing. To me, religion implies structure, dogma, tradition, and some kind of...
Religion's Roman Catholicism, spiritual's Gnosticism.
Exactly. Yeah. Or and so I'm more interested in shamanic experience than religious experience. I have had used entheogens in a religious context, which would be like taking it with the UDV or the Santo Daime, the ayahuasca churches, and in South America and Brazil. And that's actually a very different kind of experience. And the focus there is on communal experience, which of course is a real thing and it's a very valuable thing. And it's not my own personal interest, and certainly not, I'm more interested in psychonautic voyaging, the shamanic model. But there's certainly a place for that, and a lot of people want it and need it, and we certainly need to build community in a lot of ways in the modern world, and that's a good way of doing it. But there the focus is on group experience, and so they do it with the lights on, with music, with talking, and question-answer session, and the idea is so that people don't go off on a really deep voyage, but they stay kind of
in
group.
The peyote circle.
Yeah, it's a very beautiful thing, but it's just a question of personal interest. That doesn't particularly strike me, and my interest per se is not in studying religion, but in studying shamanism.
Do you think that in those situations, that those people actually enter into like a group consciousness that, say, breaks the boundaries of their, you know, individuality?
I wouldn't call it group consciousness, but they sort of shared experience, you know, some level of shared experience, a pretty deep level, I would say. Yes, but it's kind of hard to talk about group consciousness when so many people seem to have a very tenuous hold on their own consciousness, and it's a very hard thing to describe. And once you get into any kind of linguistic construction on these sort of things, you can easily run into misinterpretation. That's why maybe when I'm answering questions like that, I sound a little bit like a lawyer, because I want to make sure that we're understanding the terminology. And people tend to use words like spiritual, religious interchangeably, shamanism, religion interchangeably, so I often sound like I'm being lawyerly, saying, well, let's understand this point by point. But just as there's a reason for that in the courtroom, there's also a reason for that in science, because it's very difficult to communicate about these subjects to begin with. We're dealing with the ineffable, often, after all, and not for nothing is it called that. And so, I try to be very linguistically precise as much as possible.
Well, we'll pick this up again after a short commercial break.
Tune in Fridays at 4:20 for Higher Ground with DJ Bob on Pot TV.
Okay, welcome back. And Jonathan and I were just discussing drugs and consciousness, or entheogens and consciousness. I'm supposed to be a better term to use in presence of company here. Now, what do you think of, like, it seems to me these substances, different substances affect you different ways because they react to different areas and different receptors in your brain and stuff like that, right? Mm-hmm. And in a way, it's like, I feel like the alchemical aspect of this is it shows you like different areas of your consciousness. Maybe ecstasy really makes it tap into your heart chakra a little bit more, and something like LSD is certainly more cerebral. And it's almost like if we could separate these substances, separate these aspects of our consciousness, we could get to a deeper level of a consciousness, right? You know what I mean? That's my belief with these substances. Is mm-hmm. there's an aspect of us that is common to everybody, and that, mm-hmm. that aspect can be known through conscious utilization of the entheogens.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would agree with that. Although, in my experience, I would say the aspect is of us that's common to all of us is the animal aspect. That's the most easily identifiable one. On a sublinguistic level, going beyond the different cultural programming, linguistic programming that we might have, that we have in common with all mammals, and certainly to some extent with reptiles and birds.
But don't you think that we've been talking so long now that whatever, like, that animal instinctual force that you're talking about is now has picked up all that language alongside of this and stuff? Like, we're predispositioned for language. Our brain's structured for language.
We have words for some things and so forth, but it definitely overrides that. For example, if someone is brain dead, basically that part of the body continues and still functions without any presumably mental activity accompanying it. So, I think it's a substrate to culture, and language is the most important aspect for us of culture as linguistic beings. So that part I see is definitely common, of course, in terms of social experience too, no matter what era, what language, what area, we basically still deal with the same things as our remote ancestors did, and as our mm-hmm. as our descendants will as well. And so, I agree that one of the good aspects about this is it overrides certain filtering or certain analytical parts of consciousness to enable you to get back to more basics. And I think it is good for exploring cultural commonalities as well as biological ones.
And your experiences with the snuff Oppo, what have they been like? I've never had a chance to do anything. There's a really wonderful South American entheogenic substance. Mm-hmm. You can get chemical analogs or whatnot here in North America.
Yeah, well, that's the goal. Well, the book, I deal with three different kinds of snuff plants in this Shamanic Snuffs book. And the first one that you mentioned, Neopo or Yopo, is the Anodonanthrous nuts, which is in the pea family, Leguminosae. Anodonanthrous is the genus, and these contain glufotinine as the major tryptamine, which is 5-hydroxy-DMT or dimethyltryptamine. The second category is Virola in the nutmeg family, and those contain 5-methoxy-dimethyltryptamine, 5-MER-DMT, which is also could be called O-methyl glufotinine. It's just one carbon different from glufotinine. And the third category I deal with are tobacco or nicotianus nuts, which contain nicotine. So I did make analogs. I tried the plant versions, of course. And I did make analogs of these with the pure compounds, and that was the idea, to work out a human pharmacological analog for these snuffs. Now, as many people probably know, blufotenin has been widely dismissed as being a non-active compound, not visionary, and so forth. Well, now I know, at least, and once the book comes out, others will, that this is not the case, that it's indeed very, very active in a visionary sense, and it fits, in many respects, the classic profile of the DMT-type compounds. Blufotenin is also active orally by itself, unlike as is 5-methoxy-DMT, unlike DMT per se. So in the book I have fairly, I think a total of about 60-65 bioassays where I explored this not just in the nose, intranasally, but sublingually, because these things are taken as chews or pastes that are put in the mouth. And also by inhaling the vapor, because the seeds, these snuff seeds from Anamnanthar also smoke. In fact, they're more active that way than the snuff, as it has been the case for some preparations of Virola as well, and tobacco, of course. So I explore that, and even in the case of blufotenin, as enema, indirectly, because they're also used that way. And the experiments include also the use of ayahuasca or banisteriopsis alkaloids, in this case harmine and harmaline, because many people associate those with oral potions that are the famous ayahuasca potions, but indeed they're also used as additives to these snuff plants and to tobacco preparations. And so there's a lot of pioneering pharmacology in the book. Basically, the book will have the bulk of the relevant human literature on pharmacology of these compounds published, because there really isn't anything else to speak of.
Okay, we'll take one more break, and then we'll be back with a final conversation with Jonathan and I.
Hi, I'm Steve Cubby.
And I'm Michelle Cubby, and we're going to be doing a new show here on Pot TV called The Cubby Files. Tune in to hear about what's going on in the world and what's really happening in the world of cannabis.
Be there or stay in your chair.
Hello, my name is Mark Emery. I'm the publisher of Cannabis Culture Magazine. I'm the proprietor of Pot Television. And I urge you, if you want to grow some fine marijuana, to check out emeryseeds.com or the Emery Seeds catalog in Cannabis Culture Magazine and grow yourself some fine marijuana.
We're back with Jonathan Ott. Jonathan, in your book, Pharmacotheon, you talked about the Pharmacratic Inquisition and the rise of the Roman Catholic Church and the death of the entheogenic groups, you know, like Lucius and these different mysteries, cults and whatnot. Do you know much about the early Christian period, like the first few centuries, the Gnosticism and what was taking place?
A little bit, not a whole lot. No.
Do you see them as entheogenic cults?
Yeah, very likely. There's certainly people have interpreted some of their cryptic writings that way, but it's more than likely, because we have to remember at the time that was the rule, not the exception. And we were in what I tend to call the age of the entheogens until about the end of the 4th century in the Christian world. And I would say it's a very, very likely so.
Do you feel that move was done directly against entheogens themselves, like it was like a more of a control religion rising over an experiential...
Definitely, because especially when you consider that their liturgy is based on a sacrament, what they call a sacrament, and then they diluted the concept down to about 8 different kinds of sacraments to distract people from the patent fact that they didn't have one, or that it was what I call a placebo sacrament. So I think very definitely it was a desperate move on their part, because if people could remember or flash back to what a real sacrament was, it would be pretty obvious that what they were offering didn't cut it.
Yeah, that's for sure.
So that's why we had the desperate maneuvers for, well, a millennium and a half or so to like destroy this, which would have been perhaps successful if it hadn't been for the fact that this survived more or less intact in the New World, and then all of a sudden they took a time machine back and they found it right in front of their eyes, like 1,500 years earlier.
And groups like the Manicheans, I believe you've mentioned their mushroom eating, and they were, of course, derived from Gnostic sects and traveling. They were in China up until about the 8th century, but they were in France in the 12th, 13th century with the Cathar and Albigenese heresies. Mm-hmm. Have you ever had a chance to look at any of the material from that era? I know you read a lot of French stuff. So.
Yeah, what's left of it, because the Christians destroyed most of it, and maybe the Vatican has some secret stuff. But yeah, we know they have this consolamentum sacrament. We have good reason to suspect it might have been a mushroom, and from studying, pushing it back to their original connection with Mani, the Persian prophet, and so forth, and also the Chinese connection. There are little bits and pieces of evidence that point to Amanita muscaria as this consolamentum sacrament, which was especially administered as a kind of a last rites when they were on their deathbeds.
Rabelais mentions the Amanita muscaria, definitely Cathar.
And that area, southern France, the Pyrenees, northern Spain, the Basque country, that area, according to the original studies of the Wassons back in the 1930s, is what an island of so-called mycophilia in Europe and surrounded by this hatred of mushrooms. Well, that's where you have the opposite. And one of my colleagues who's from Catalonia, from Barcelona, Fericla, Joseph Maria Fericla, he has found surviving sort of recreational use of Amanita muscaria in 20th century Spain, or politically Spain, in Catalonia, which also tends to point in that direction.
Although Amanita muscaria is growing, proficiently around here in BC, I've never actually done them. It's like, and I've heard so many varied reports from people, like from people that had no effect to people that had very too much of an effect, that I've always had a bit of a problem believing that it played such an important role as an entheogen in the ancient world, just because of all the variables involved with its ingestion.
Well, also, it's the main variable is chemical, the potency.
Is that very geographically?
Yes, and also within a given area. And most of the reports that I've heard where people have trouble getting off on it are from North America, not from Europe. It's basically an old world species. But it did exist in the New World up and down through Central America. There weren't any in South America pre-contact. And the maximum extent of the traditional use of it in the Americas is the Mayan area. That was one of the principal entheogens for them. But in the Northwest, I started my career actually studying that back in the 70s, and I published some papers on it. I found Amanita pantherina to be most reliable in terms of toxicity, which is the brown cap one. It's very similar, except the cap is dark chocolate brown with white warts. That's in Washington State, in the way, much more potent and reliable, but there it's a spring mushroom, whereas muscaria is more of a fall, although you can see them in the spring. We would get the panthers in May, would be the best time. You get these varying reports. I just took them in Colombia, not far from Bogota, some months ago, for the first time in many years. And there they're introduced with foreign trees. These were under pine trees. And they were quite potent. One mushroom was a very, very effective dose.
Well, again, with the soma that yourself and other researchers have tied with Amanita, it seems like that is done in such large doses. Isn't the Amanita somewhat like toxic in its effects? It makes you kind of sick?
Some people get nausea from it, but also there are some who get nausea from the psilocybe mushroom too. But it's potent, but not in a deadly sense. It has that reputation, but that's part of the mycophobia. It's really not a deadly poisonous mushroom. For that matter, there are anti-mushroom people can point to a couple of deaths of children that have been attributed to psilocybe mushrooms in the 1960s in Oregon State. But that was not a very reliable job. There was no real solid evidence which mushroom was involved, but it could well have been. But there is some evidence that children can get an anomalous hyperthermia or high body temperature from psilocybin, and that was the kind of results that were presented. But one of the strange things that passed uncommented on that case, so the kids had eaten this mushroom growing on a lawn, and then they later cultured mycelium from the ground and got Psilocybe baocystis mushroom out of that, and that was partly what they based their identification on. But one of the things that passed overlooked on that is one of the I think one of the children died in the hospital with hyperthermia. The other one went back and ate the mushrooms again some days later. So that's kind of been glossed over in that case.
That is interesting. Now, with the soma, and before I jump into this, I'd just like to say that, you know, I'm probably stepping out of my league here. With the soma, a number of writers like Elaine Danilow, A.L. Basham, Steve Hager from High Times, have suggested that it was cannabis, not the amino muscaria. Hager argues that certain Vedic references to the soma clothing the poor and healing the sick, in reference to a plant with fibrous and medicinal properties as well. The hyoma was reputed to be woven into a necklace for protection. And some references to twigs and branches. My own copy of the 10th mandala, which is totally nonpartisan as far as any sort of entheogenic references, just strictly a religious text, refers to the colors in the translation that I have, as both it calls it the purple tree, and then talks about the stone's faces being turned green from pressing the soma. Dan Lowe suggests that this is the same way that we make bong by pressing, you know, and it's a very similar technique with the milk. Whereas somebody like Clark Heinrich, whose book I thought was really weak in a lot of ways, he was using medieval paintings to argue ancient arguments, which is just didn't jive for me. He says that the agaric is dried and then rewatered and then melted of its psychoactive substance. Isn't that how he argues it? The references that I've read to the urination and the re-drinking of that, some of them almost seem like, you know, we drink the soma and Indra pisses back, you know, the flowing soma. It almost like seem to me to have, you know, elements of imitative magic made by drinking the soma that bring on the monsoon rains and makes the plants grows. And then
maybe it's just an early piss testing industry.
The early piss testing is here. Well, there's a whole area of Vedic thing of drinking urine as well, right? And then when the beggar drinks, Indra's disguised as a beggar, and the guy drinks his piss and has an enlightening experience again. It's like he's so holy, even his piss is like. What makes you feel that the soma, the ancient substance, which apparently was taken in such large quantities and induced an obviously blissful state, because it's it just doesn't seem to me from the literature that I've read that the Animedia is known for producing that blissful state, and Wasson even commented that was the case, you know.
Well, it certainly has for some people, and it has for me. I don't have any strong opinion about it one way or the other. I just think for linguistic reasons, the evidence is pretty good that it was a mushroom because of various linguistic connections, not necessarily an Amanita mushroom. And, of course, remember in the Atharva Veda, they churn the oceans and out come both bong and Amrita.
Well,
it's two different
there's
things.
There's also a reference where it says the soma is the kingdom, five kingdoms herbs, the Susha grass.
And it grows in the mountains, and cannabis would be more of a plain thing.
Well,
but it could also, of course, grow in the mountains. They had it cultivated in the plains. They don't describe it as being a cultivated thing either.
I kind of have thought that it was a generic term, you know what I mean? Whatever they got.
It definitely can
consecrated,
be
as a soma. And
well, a term like equivalent to entheogen.
Yeah.
In which case it would be both and. Any mushroom they had, or of course cannabis would.
Yeah, or whatever particular
entheogen. We know they have lots of substitute plants they describe that way also. I know that's Christian Rentsch's conclusion, that it's basically just a generic term.
That's what I felt too when I was writing Green Gold. I did a paper on it recently, and that was, you know, just so much, because there is some evidence where it does certainly sound like a mushroom, and there is some evidence where it sounds like cannabis, and there's not some evidence where it could be something else as well. So I kind of hold that generic, that it was consecrated and made soma in a ritual and ingested. Well, I just wanted to say it's been a great pleasure here, and maybe you want to just give information about that conference one more time.
Yeah, I just wanted to invite everyone to attend the conference, Entheobotany 2, which is 11 through 13 May, Whistler Convention Center in Whistler, B.C., and we'll have 20 of the top researchers in this field, including, of course, in the hemp area, Lester Grinspoon from Harvard, of the Marijuana, the Forbidden Medicine book. But it'll be well worth it. It's a three-day event, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
On the road again.
Nearly 700,000 Americans were arrested on marijuana charges last year.
That's an enormous waste of law enforcement resources and terribly unfair to those arrested and their families. It's time we stopped arresting adults who smoke marijuana responsibly. For more information, visit Normal's website at www.normal.org or call toll-free 888-67-NORMAL and tell them Willie sent you.